we're going to do here. Just like the Sideshow, I think this event is never out, it's never over. It's going to be continuing on. Later today, well, Franco will say a few more words about what we're going to do today. There's going to be a few informal activities, some getting together, kind of debriefing, and some fun stuff. I'll get things started here. Basically, we're going to run this. Originally, it was going to be a all-out roast of Ward Hall, but I got to tell you. Yeah, I know.
Don't talk about it.
Anyway,
I had more people in my room last night. Boys or girls?
No shin.
Well, my friends, we have gathered here today, dearly beloved, because we want to pay tribute to a man who has done so much for the Sideshow, a man who has inspired us all. We wanted to do that, but Jim Rose couldn't be here today. So instead, we're going to say a few words about Mr. Ward Hall. I will make this rather brief.
I thought you said you were going to honor some great Sideshow person. I thought you were talking about Kelly Kelly.
Hey, she was good.
By the way, just for your information, the hotel wants this to be totally G-rated. So I told you we should.
God awful.
So, now, Ward has been around. He's been in the business for many years. He's old. He's an old man. Let's be very honest. I'm not saying he's
old.
How old
is he?
He's so old. His social security number is 3. That's how old he is. And you know, he's been in this business for a while. As a matter of fact, the first thing he did was a magic act and a ventriloquism act. And I'm not saying he did that for a while, but he was the after-dinner entertainment at the Last Supper. That's how long he has been in the business. But he's best known, of course, for his work in the Sideshow. He got involved as a performer first, and then became a showman. And throughout the years, you bought out the shows of Dick Best, Pete Kortz, Bert Steinmetz, and Walter Wannis.
Slim Kelly.
Slim Kelly, yeah. And basically, bought out everyone's show and killed the industry. That basically what he did. And the interesting thing about it, now, this is something that perhaps James Taylor will want to do some research on, or any of the other scholars in here, do a little research on. I don't know if there's any connection here, but as the Sideshow started to kind of fade out, it seems like there were more and more, or fewer shows, but the shows that did survive, the girl shows left, the black shows left, the posing shows, but the freak animal shows seem to have maintained. So basically on the midway these days, you see Ward Hall's World of Wonders and the freak animal shows. Now, I was wondering why this was, until just recently I was in the Sioux Empire Fair, and was standing in the tent of John Strong. John, stand up. Oh, anyway. John, he's not here. I was in his Freak Animal Show tent, and we were standing there talking, and we were talking about the legendary Ward Hall. And perhaps it was my imagination. I don't know if there's any connection here. But there's basically just the Sideshow and a lot of freak animal shows, but every time we mention Ward's name, the five-legged goat said, "Daddy, I don't know." Might have been my heart rate. But seriously, folks, this is a wonderful man, and I'm honored to have gotten to rub up against him a number of occasions on the midway there. And, there was a wonderful moment. And the big, lovely thing that was going to finish off this roast that we were trying to get together, and thanks, I'd like to thank the U.S. Postal Service for fucking us over, was when we were going to play a tape of a little segment that was done just this last week, a couple days ago, by Penn and Teller.
Which we paid big money
Never see that coin again. Anyway, and unfortunately it's been lost in the mail, so we will get that to you. But the one of the great things was that I think the first time I met Ward was years and years ago at the Meadowlands Fair with Penn and Teller. We had known them for years, and we went out to the fair, and we walked into the tent, and there was Ward at the other end, and he goes, "Oh, my goodness, what an honor!" And he came over and said, "I've been looking forward to meeting you, Todd Robbins." And Penn and Teller like,
"Why, well, I already knew them."
So it is an honor. Basically, as you can tell, the same mean things about him ain't gonna get laughs, because he is just a beloved person, and you know, it's it.
Wait till I get up.
Yeah, I know. But there are a few that are gonna give the college try. But so this is gonna be kind of a mixed roast and toast, simple as that. And I'm gonna bring up our next little speaker here to come forth and bring joy to the room, as he always does. I'm talking about the man responsible for Shocked and Amazed, and that's not just the vest that he's wearing. No, sir. I give you Mr. James Taylor. Thanks.
I'm never formal. In spite of the fact that I know a lot of you think I'm wearing this because I just love to wear clothes that are totally outrageous, I'm actually wearing this to wake up this morning. In any event, I'm not going to say a lot of cruel and horrible things about Ward, but many years ago, a showman told me, and it was not Ward, but many years ago a showman told me that a sideshow was the pitch without a product. Well, I thought that was really funny at the time, and he thought it was pretty comical himself, but I realized that what he really meant was that it was a pitch without a product, to a certain extent, for the audience, unless they were wised up, because obviously the product is here in this room this morning and all this weekend. And in no small part due to Ward and his likes over the years, as our predecessors that I've been trying to document. But I do want to tell one story about Ward, and then I'll have a seat before my voice gives out, because of course this is due to laryngitis and not the fact that I've been talking all weekend. Years ago, when I first started to work on Shocked and Amazed, one of the first calls that I made to any of the people in the business was to this gentleman. And it was because I just picked up a copy of My Very Unusual Friends, which is probably the most aptly titled book on planet Earth. And when I called Ward up, he was very pleasant.
Just look around the room here.
Yes. That's all you have to do is look at your compatriots.
Still have a few copies left for sale.
But I think I have all of them here, so that's okay.
And they were blessed by the Pope, I want you to know. So.
That's a dangerous thing to say nowadays.
I know.
I got one. $26.
In any event,
I'll give you your own diocese next year.
Yeah, that's right. I don't know if I'm going to go beyond that.
Catholicism, the feel-good religion. Thank you. So,
and Ward's primary piece of advice to me when I said that I wanted to do this book, and I was going to go out and interview show people, and I was going to run around like I was crazy, taking pictures of all these shows and acts and traveling all over the place. He's like, you don't want to do that. The business is dead. You should be doing this in a library. I want you to know it's probably the only time I can swear that Ward Hall lied to me, but I've been trying to keep track ever since. So, Ward, it's a pleasure to have met you. You're not going anywhere anytime soon, I know, but I want to be able to say that in front of a room of your peers, anyways.
Speak louder than words. We like that. Wonderful, wonderful. Well, let's move on. You know, it's great being. I mentioned this at the opening, and I will say this again. We have several people here who have just started in this. Anyway, so I would like to bring up the other red meat. And just say a few words. Red Stewart, ladies and gentlemen.
you very much for all the years we've had meeting people. I'm sorry, I put them all to shame that day. Anyway, and all of the young, new performers, the way the industry is changing, I thank all of you. I have gotten to meet some friends that I haven't seen in years. Red Tower, the ward, I still love you. Yeah.
Who knew it was going to turn out like that?
Yeah. It's a personal thing.
Yeah. And I think it also is just a wonderful thing that shows the character of the man, that he would come here and be with all of us on one of the busiest weekends of the season, which means that Chris gets first count, and that's... Trust me. The good thing about the problem with the sideshow, well, there are many problems with the sideshow, but one of the problems is that throughout the people, except for James Taylor, get up in the morning and go, I am going to go and see a sideshow today. It is something that occurs to them because the outside talker has convinced them to come in and see the big show on the inside. And the problem with this, unlike magic show, who did what, when, and where. And I would just like to applaud the folks that are trying to put this down on paper and save this for our generation and the future generation, the historians and the collectors and the folks that are writing about it. And I think they deserve just a round of applause. I'm going to bring one up now, as a matter of fact, a gentleman who wrote a great book, a wonderful book on one of the big... Sit down. it is a gentleman who wrote a great book on the girl shows, and aptly titled Girl Show. And formed a committee, did a study, hired a whole marketing to come up with that name. I don't know if it's going to be the next book, but in the pipe, coming down the pipe from him, is going to be a book on the sideshow. And I am truly looking, I'm going to give him money right now for the first copy of it. Mr. Al Stenson, would you come up here?
I thought I was going to do it up there. I sent as far away as I could.
Good.
I
need to be in the witness protection program. No.
Well, thank you very kindly. I appreciate that. This is amazing what Todd's done to bring all your people together. And it's sensational. And it's a pleasure to be here to honor.
Buy yourself something, please.
You like new underwear? The honor Ward Hall, because I don't know if you know my background, but I'm trying to write about the business I like, which was the carnival business, the business I first started in as a youngster, is going away from home on a carnival when I was 12. That's the business I liked, but I ended up realizing I couldn't make any money in it and went to the circus business and spent my life in the circus business. And by the time I was 20, I owned my own tent circus in conjunction with Johnny Frazier, and I went on to own my own show 4 years later and spent 19 years running a circus. But my love was also in the carnival business, where all these people I ran into were collecting circus memorabilia and circus posters.
I wanted carnival stuff, and luckily at the time they just sort of give it to you because they didn't want it. They didn't know what it was, and they didn't care about it. Fortunately, now we have a group that are preserving carnival history. And it's not like the girl shows. When I got three boxes of girl show material that belonged to Jack Norman at a flea market and started thinking this would make a good book, And 8 years later, when the book finally came out, almost all the people I had interviewed had died. So it's, you know, it's a pleasure to have a living specimen here that we can honor.
That's my study.
There's not a lot around. So my point is, you better talk to these people now, and you better talk to people like John Prower. People that are around, you better root them up, and you better go to their homes, their trailers, and talk to them, because that's you're preserving history. You don't have a lot of time to do it. But I just want to say, a guy showed me a sign inside a grind show ticket box, and that's my parting words. I just want to say how much the industry respects Ward Hall, and as a showman, he can't be beat. And my parting words are the little sign inside this grind show ticket box, only visible as you leave, and it said, pay your money promptly, take your screwing gently, and leave quickly.
Not bad for a Canadian. There you go. Hey.
I hate Canadians.
That's about all the alphabet they know. So,
That's how we got caught going across the border. They'd ask you, what's the last letter of the alphabet?
I hate Canadians. They're coming in this country and taking all the jobs that are Mexicans.
I'm just going to jump ahead here, because I got a little note, fan mail from some flounder. A very good friend of ours. Do you want to come up here and say something?
I'll just stand up.
Okay. For those of you who don't know, this guy's been running around taking photos. That's what he does. He is, actually, you know what you should do? Is you should probably get together with Bruce Snowden and find out what his diet is. Because then you could be figuratively and literally the biggest circus fan in the world. But
I loved you on Captain Kangaroo.
First fire bell.
So this is Paul Cuthiel, who's just a great photographer, and I just like to say, and I've said this before, and I'll keep saying it until someone believes it, that when you look down the road, and we're all sitting, old men and women, looking at books that are written about circus in the latter part of the 20th century and early part of the 21st century, the majority of the photos that are going to be in that book have been taken by this man, because he's taken literally thousands of photos. He's a good guy, and so you can sit down now, because it's going to be downhill from
here.
Well,
this has nothing to do with what I wanted to say.
Oh, well.
What I wanted to say was about Ward.
Uh-oh.
The day that Penn and Teller were visiting Ward at the Meadowlands Fair, I was out taking a picture of the front, and Ward came out and said, could you come back inside for a minute? I'd like you to take a picture of me with my friends Penn and Teller. I'm naive. I said, Ward, are you pulling my leg? He said, no. Sure. There they were, two charming gentlemen. And I, in my naivete at one point, and this is the whole point of why I'm standing here, I said to Teller, I had no idea that Ward Hall had such high-class friends. Teller looked me right in the eye and said, oh no, it is we that have high-class friends.
Yeah. The next person to come forward here, speaking of collectors, is a man who has collected much and actually has collected some personalities along the way. I refer to our good friend, Professor Ouch.
Thank you. say something from the fan and collect your viewpoint, if I can, before my voice goes, because I don't have the ears in front of a ballet going all day like these guys. But no one is more gracious and more of a friend of people interested in the sideshow than Ward. When I met him, I don't know, 10, 12, 15 years ago, whenever it was, I was walking on the sideshow, or I was walking down the midway, lamenting that there was no sideshows, and there was his 150-some-odd-foot banner line with fat man and bearded woman and tattooed person in red, and it blew me away. And I'm sure the fans and the dealers like Bob that have been doing it longer than myself know that Ward will help anybody out, point them in the right direction, sell them anything they can on a bad day, and you know, you can't get anything good out of him on a good day, but he's filled all of our collections and all our hearts with memories. I had a bunch of notes written, but the reality is Ward is probably the last of the freak show kings and last of the really great showmen and probably one of my favorite and somebody I look up to the most out of everybody I've met in this business and pretty much anything I've done, except for this guy. But I think Bob and the other collectors, dealers, the publishers, and anybody that's researched it, like James will tell you, you know, Ward is a walking encyclopedia, a walking piece of history, and a wonderful, wonderful, dear, sweet man. I'm glad I met him. I'm sure we're all glad we know him. In the far off strange country of
Anthrax.
The same strange country of Gibson's, I found this. It's something I want to present to Ward. It's the I found it's a shrunken head of Ward Hall.
Because everyone knows there's nothing Ward Hall likes better than a little head. So that's
I love this place. You see, Lizard Man just snuck in. Like, yeah. No one will see Lizard Man. That was so cool, Lizard Man. Nobody saw it.
No, yeah. Your secret is safe with us.
Yeah. It's all about we're in church.
Yeah. I don't know what church you've been going to.
That's the one. Yeah.
Not in my church, but.
Did the ceiling collapse yet?
What was that? No. And I don't think hell is freezing over yet, so it's we'll continue on. Let's continue on. Speaking of, from the collector point of view, a gentleman who has just an amazing collection of stuff, and I hope he got a chance. Bob, have you closed up, or have you still got stuff there? You all closed
as
up?
As long as there's a human being, there's a bone saw. One taught me
that. Yeah. Actually, it's got. Bob, why don't you come on up here while I introduce you?
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
We've got Bob Blackmore. Just an amazing collection of stuff. Go by and look at the thing, and if you have any money left, give it to this man. He also puts out a wonderful thing that if you don't know about this, you should know about this. Every once in a while, you get in the mail one of the coolest things ever, which is his Sideshow newsletter. You continue on to do that? You're going to do that?
Of course. Oh, good. Subscriptions are available.
Yeah, subscription. It's free, but donations are always appreciated, and it is great. Each of these newsletters has reprints of materials from his collection, other sources, on various subjects. Like there'll be one on giants, one on fat ladies, dwarves. That was kind of a short issue, though. And all the other various and sundry things in the sideshow. And there's just things in there that you didn't know existed. And so by all means, go by and say hi to Bob. And let's say hi to him now. Say a few words.
Yeah.
Bob Blackmore.
I know I'm going to break up, and I'm not a public speaker. I don't know if anybody can hear me. When I was sitting up there, the first thing I thought I'd do is just stand up there behind the camera crew and drive them nuts. You know, Ward taught me that. Ward's taught me so much through the years. He and Chris have been friends for a long time, and first I thought there was things I was going to say, and then I saw, heard furry, and I'm thinking of other things, but looking at Ward, I saw his carnation, and I realized as I get older, I better start wearing a suit and a jacket. And the reason for this is that if you have the carnation, you're ready to be handled, you know. So now I am going to break up. But Ward and Chris have been great friends for a long time. When I first met Ward, I was connected with Circus. And I could talk about people, and probably three people in here would know who I was talking about. Chris, that really taught me the tricks of the trade was Jimmy Hand. And probably Ward's the only one that will laugh, but Jimmy taught me every damn bad thing you could learn about show business, and it stood me well. And then what he didn't teach me, Ward taught me. And through the years, we've had a lot of dealings, and Chris has said many times when we were in a group, he said, this is Bob Blackmore, he said, through the years, Bob and I have had all kinds of dealings, and thousands of dollars in dealings, and he said, neither one of us has ever seen a dollar bill, no green. And the other thing I would say, a little anecdote, Ward taught me about dumpsters. I thought I knew everything about shit, dumpsters, and whatever. But we were playing Levittown, Pennsylvania one year. And look up the end of the midway, because we expected Ward to come visit, because I think you're at Penn Salem. And I thought I saw him get out of his car at the head of the midway, but he disappeared. So I had other things to do, and all of a sudden Ward's there. So before I could say anything, Ward said, well, so you've been doing a lot of business because I'm in concessions. A lot of business. I ain't done nothing but dying. This is a bank. He said, well, why is the dumpster filled? He said, when I come on the lot, I always check the dumpster to see how my competition's doing, the business. I said, oh, this is a buyout. The sponsor had competition concessions, and of course they were half my price. I was dying. They were the ones who were making all the money.
Sure.
I just want to say again, I've got an awful lot to thank Ward and Chris for. And he's a wonderful guy, and I hope we're all around. Because the longer he's around, I know I'm still around. Thanks again.
There's someone else who is a scholar and a collector, and
there's Red Chower was a sword swallower for us, Johnny Mia. We had John Bradshaw doing pitches, not sword swallowing at that time. But one of the other performers was Jay Marshall, who's now the designated Dean of American Magicians. And Ward's truck had pulled up on the mall side of the Museum of American History, and of course it had, you know, Paul and Chris present Wondercade emblazoned across the side of it. And Jay Marshall took one look at that truck and Hall and Crisp, Wondercade, and he said, leave it to Ward Hall to take top billing over Christ.
I loved you in Crocodile Dundee. Yeah.
Thank you. It's pretty amazing to look around the room and see my family. There was no paper trail. I think we should all be glad of that, because otherwise there'd be a lot of people after our asses. And they'd be really
subpoenas.
Those
we got. Those.
And they'd be really lucky because they'd catch us all together in one room at the same time. That's quite unusual. I don't know what to say. Todd asked me if I would do something. It's just say a couple of words, and I thought, well, every other time anybody's ever said that to me, I've just stood up and said a few words and sat down again. And I can't do that for Ward, because we're roasting. Actually, we don't have to roast him, because he's already half-baked. But I'm allowed to say that, because it takes one to know one, and I'm half-baked, too. And I think we can all say that. I didn't recognize you when I came in, Ward, that suit. You know, I never saw Ward in a suit before. I've only known Ward a couple of years. I knew who he was for a long time, because we all have that kind of reputation. But, you know, I came to praise him, not to bury him. So I'll praise you, Ward. I have to say that I have very rarely in my life met a person who was even close to half as gracious as Ward is. I have to thank you for the nice things you've had to say, the conversations we've had, the few times we've actually managed to get together. And I hope we get to have many more.
We will.
Thank you.
Hear, hear. He looks better than the guy that was buried in it originally.
We had to dig him up.
Yeah.
And I think that goes for all of us, that our relationship with the Ward here.
How long did you spend underground with Attaways?
So, I'd like to bring up a man. That's about all you can say about it.
Why are you sure?
Yeah. What can you say about this guy, AJ, that has been already included in a police report? He is a friend of all of us. He's done many, many things. Can I give him some of the? Can I?
No one's here.
Can I blow the gap a lot?
Sure.
Let me up the marks. What you might not know about this guy,
gorgeous, so I can blackmail him.
Okay. But what you might not know about him is that he also has had many, many careers. He grew up. He cut his teeth on the Midway. He's a carny bastard, basically, and spent many, many years, formative years on the lot, being with it. And as a matter of fact, he's writing a book that is going to be great about his early years and the stuff that he learned. And it's got a fabulous title. I mean, just an unforgettable title. A wonderful, wonderful, wonderful title.
He gave it to me.
Yeah, I know. the book is going
if
to be...
If he says it's a gift, he'll ask for something later.
But slowly. By the way, did I mention we were thinking about buying a house? We need some of the co-sign alone, but anyway, we'll talk about that later. Anyway, the book is going to be called Carnival Knowledge, and this guy knows about this. After that, and doing a little work for the government overseas, he was in the army. He got out and was in Chicago. I'm going to tell a very short and bad version of this because I know you're not going to do it. He went to an audition. There was an audition in Chicago many, many years ago, and they were looking for clowns. And the weird thing about the audition is they paid, what was it, $30 or 30?
35.
$35. And which is unheard of for an audition. So they had, was it 15 or 16?
17,
including you. All right, thank you. So there were 17 clowns showed up for this audition. And they got up and they did the balloon animals and they did their magic tricks and they did their little funny things in each and every one of them. And there's a guy sitting there and he was watching them. He said, okay, great. All right, and they all did their thing. And then he said, now would you one at a time step to the microphone and sing a chorus of Down by the Riverside? And they all looked at this guy like a nuts. And 16 of them said, we'll take our check now. And they got their $35 and left. And one of them, this guy, walks up to my throne and starts singing, I'm like, my soul, she, down by the river. And I said, okay, fine, you have the job. He said, well, what is this job? He said, well, we're starting up this thing. I bought this company and we're starting up this thing and we need sort of this ambassador, kind of icon. And I bought this little company. My name is Ray Crawford. It's called McDonald's. And we want you to be this character we created called Ronald McDonald. This is the one and only Ronald McDonald. Chancy thing, but I just did because it is basically pulling the mask off of Batman and saying, you know, ladies and gentlemen, Superman. Oh, you know, he's Clark Kent also because this is a wonderful thing that AJ spent 35 years creating the magic of that character and being responsible for all the Ronald McDonald's worldwide, over 300 of them, and overseeing all the commercials and things like that. Somehow, in the midst of all that, he spent a great deal of time touring around being a stand-up comedian and
writing books, again, Golden Rule Shoes, great book, phenomenal book, and being a very high paid, ridiculously high paid, motivational speaker for major corporations traveling around the world doing that. And but that money's all been spent, so he's here today.
I got 7 books left.
So ladies and gentlemen, to say a few kind words, my ass, I give you the one and only AJ.
That's it. I'm done. Hi, my name is AJ. And I smoked pot one time. For 35 years. But I never inhaled. But I did drink that water from the bong. But enough about me. You say something about me. I've been knowing Ward for 45 years. I'll never forget the first words Ward ever said to me, "Get away!" I know a lot about his history. A little known fact is his grandfather was killed in the Auschwitz death camp in Poland. He had gotten drunk and fell out of a gun tower. His parents, then here in America, in the 50s were financially wiped out, like many were, when automatic pin setters came in. My father, and he had played the Badger State shows years ago, said of Ward one of the greatest compliments one could say for another man. He said, "AJ, Ward could steal your chickens while you were feeding them." He is a warm, sensitive, loving individual. I don't know if you know that part about him, but the man actually cries when he has sex.
How would you know?
But then again, Mace will do that to you. He has an affinity for children. He loves children. He'll do anything. I don't care if it's toys, candy, magic tricks, anything to get them in the van. And then eventually end up on his show. Who he refers to as his family. Which is equal to the bar scene at Star Wars. No offense, listen. It's very, very interesting because, and Frank, by the way, nice job you did here today. And you have one fan member. Would you put your hat back on? There you go. What you've done here is super. And just for me to be here among all these wonderful performers is wonderful. And give yourselves a hand of applause. You kicked ass yesterday and the day before. Chris Christ, Ward's Sancho Panza's partner for going to 30 years. One of the cleverest guys in the world.
38 years.
38 years. Seems only like 80. He's a great guy, and he has a great sense of humor, and he does something that I asked Ward permission if I could even tell this story. Inside the menagerie, they have this huge python in there, and on the back wall, it says, the gypsies believe that if you put money in by the snake, your wish will come true. And then under it says, all donations will be given to the Christ Memorial Fund for Animals. That's Christ's last name. Christ, spelled the same way, okay? But, you know, as you will have a partnership, it's sometimes up and down and arguing and et cetera. And Chris was a little nervous about him and went to a psychiatrist and said, I don't want to start anything, but I think Ward's trying to poison me. And the doctor said, don't panic. I know him. Let me talk to him. And he called in Ward and he talked to him, called Chris back in and said, look, I listened to Ward for 3 hours. Take the poison.
At least the cheek's gonna fall off. Don't do that.
You know, and I said to him, I said, you know, you're getting on a little bit. How's your sex life? And he says, not that great. I said, Viagra. Try Viagra. And he said, me taking Viagra would be like me putting a new flagpole on a condemned building. There is so much Viagra in Florida that I'm so surprised that that state doesn't break away and point towards New York. That's one thing that shocks me about it. And the best thing about it is it's DNA. It's always DNA. I mean, he went to the doctor and he got an examination, and the doctor said, for a guy your age, you're in great shape. He said, how old was your dad when he died? And Ward said, who said my dad's dead? He says, he's not? He says, no, he's alive and well, and he's right now 99 years old. He says, well, see, it's still DNA. How old was your grandfather when he died? He says, who said my grandfather's dead? He says, he's not dead. He says, not only is he not dead, but he's getting married, and he's right now 116. He's 116. Why the hell would he want to get married? He says, who said he wants to? It's so true. I got to tell you something. He has given more jobs and taken care of more people and been a symbol in this business. Even with that said, the size of his funeral will depend on the weather. The size of his funeral will depend on his weather. There's no microphone here. Never mind. In the end, there's a wonderful story about an old man that goes to a doctor, and the doctor says to the old man, what's the matter? And the old man says, I can't pee. And the doctor says, you can't pee. How old are you? He says, I'm 98 years old. The doctor says, you've peed enough. What? You've peed enough.
You brought up Chris's name, and I'm just going to tell one quick anecdote by way of introduction for the man of the hour here, or half hour, as it were. And a number of years ago, when they were playing the Meadowlands, they would kind of trade off coming into the city, and I would have custody of Ward one day, and then I'd have custody of Chris the next day. And Chris and I were walking around, and I said, well, it's about lunchtime. Why don't we go have lunch? And I said, listen, I'm buying. He goes, oh, well. He was joking. He goes, oh, wow, that's so nice. You're buying. He says, I usually don't get treated this well, you know. And I say, I know your partner is a very mean man. I understand. He goes, oh, well, yeah. And I said, you know, not only that, but I hate to tell you, but some people,
referred to him as a carny. And Chris dropped the act right then and there and said, don't ever use that term around Ward, the word carny. He says, because it used to be fine to use years and years ago. Nowadays, when you say carny, people think the carny's just a bunch of drug addicts, cokeheads, crackheads, lowlifes. He said, it's true, but that's beside the point. He said, no. He said, Ward is a showman. And he said, the difference between a carny and a showman is the difference between chicken shit and chicken salad. So, ladies and gentlemen, the finest chicken salad you will ever meet, Mr. Ward Hall.
Representing Pete here today.
I'm glad somebody is, because Pete is my little man.
You own one too.
Yeah. Not in paper. And I don't know how long you two guys have been working together.
10 minutes.
about as long as you can stand him. Pete has been with me a while, but he's very, well, I have to say, he's very unreliable, and he probably won't stay. He's only been with me for 49 years. Thank you, Todd.
Thank you, Ward.
Everybody. I thought I wasn't going to get emotional.
Obviously, he got the count from Chris.
I have to get this over with as quickly as possible because I've got to return the suit to the rental agent.
Overdue and out of style.
I want to thank everybody. Not going to start mentioning names, I might miss someone. Red Trawler probably was responsible as much as anyone for my being broke many times. Red is a genius, not only a marvelous performer, but a genius at building and designing. He built a Great Illusions. We had a show one time with, and I forget what her name was, but the living two-headed girl, and he perfected an illusion that was so great. You looked at this illusion, what you looked at this woman, and she had two heads, and they sang duets, and they performed together, and we spent at least $45,000-$50,000 perfecting this white elephant that never could get enough money to pay for the tickets though. But anyway, it was a great show. Why it didn't work, I don't know, but Red did a great job. Then we went to South America one time to visit a guy that had worked for us several years, toured with us in a big show in Mexico for 2 years, Vince Garman, the great magician, maybe you know him. And while we were there, we went to visit the Tijani show. It's probably the most beautiful tent show in the world. And I said, oh my God, this is what I want to do. So I came back and Red built a stage like Tijani's, had 8 sets of scenery on it. We put the elephant act on it. We had 17 major illusions. We had a line of chorus girls, models, an orchestra in which Johnny Mia was the drummer. Great, he's a great musician, among other things. And it was a beautiful show. It took 20 trucks to carry it. And so Red helped me with that.
and it lasted 3.5 weeks. I lost $1.5 million. So, but on the other hand, in the sideshow, Red helped me make a lot of money, as did this Red over here and other people in this room. The sideshow business is a great business. I made fortunes in the sideshow business. There are fortunes yet to be made. And I believe, honestly, that if a showman will take out a sideshow, and it may be one of you, you're capable of doing it. It's hard work. How many shows did you do in one day for me?
About a half a dozen a day, if not more.
Half a dozen a day. That was the day we got rained out.
15-20 minutes, I don't know, 4 or 5 an hour.
Yeah. So, for 12 hours. 15,
12 hours, 16 hours.
How many shows was your, the most you ever did with me?
Probably when we was in the Meadowlands and we had the organic song, probably about 30, 35.
Yeah. Okay, Doc Swan, who was here yesterday and had a show to do today.
I like to wore him up.
Was, yeah, he was there the same day that he's talking about, and Doc kept count, and he told me yesterday they did 42 shows.
One day.
So you can make a lot of money, but boy, do you have to work for it. I have stood on a ballot platform for 8-10 hours at a time, never put down the microphone. And I don't think anybody wants to work that hard, and nobody should. The fairs of yesterday don't exist today like they did then. I played Dallas, Texas for 17 consecutive years. Both those guys were there with me at different times. And in those days, from about 72 through 87, every year the opening hour would be about 15 minutes later for each day. I can remember when we used to get up, because it's in October, we used to get up in Dallas in the morning to get the first show ready. And we turned on the lights, and it'd still be dark. And you don't have to work quite as hard as we did. But believe me, there's a lot of money to be made out there, and you can make a fortune in the sideshow business.
Are you writing this down?
And what the hell are we doing?
Now, it's harder today to make that money because the business has changed so. Today they have universal tickets, and today they have pay one price almost every day, which is very difficult for a show to work against if you're going for cash and not participating in the pay one price, which I certainly would advise anyone never to do because they don't give you a very good count on your share of the money. But if you do that, if you decide to go out and make a lot of money, don't do then what Ward Hall and C.M. Chris did, to take the money and want to do something else all the time. Over the years I wrote and then produced several musical comedies. Well, if you want to have a musical comedy, go to somebody that writes a good one. You know, don't use one of mine. And so I made a lot of money in the side trips, and I would blow it. We had a tire company one time that was a disaster. I could go on and on, terrible. The side trip business is hard work, but also can be a lot of fun because you get a group of people together and they become a family. I told you how long the dwarf was with me. My fat man has been there now 26 years. He's very old.
He can't go nowhere.
He is very old for a fat man, and the doctors say one of the reasons that he has been able to exist and live so long is because of the very fact that he is in a business he enjoys and with people he enjoys. The same is true with Little Pete. I hate to tell you this, but doctors tell me that the life expectancy for a dwarf is 46. I hope you live to be much older than that. Pete's 72, he's still going strong, and as we speak, he'll be on the ballot platform today in Jackson, Tennessee.
And he's 45 and a half.
It's been nice to know you! I can't say enough about my partner. He is the guy that has made everything possible because he's always done all the work, just a workaholic, and also he is probably one of the best publicists and promoters in the world, and that's what he would really rather be doing than what he's doing right now. But so I have to thank Chris for our success. And he's not here today, obviously. He'd love to be here. He has a lot of friends here. And as would Little Pete like to be here. But Ward Hall, being the generous and kind person that he is, old man Hall, don't allow the slaves off in the plantation. And so they are all at work today, as is our sword swallower, Molotov, and the knife throwing act, Matthew Beauvoir, and Felicity Perez, and Cha-Cha, the girl on the glass, and ZZ, the girl on the nail board, and the girl that works in the electric chair, and Paul, and Jimmy Long, and all the others are hard at work so that I can be here, and I appreciate that. I would like to point my finger at the fellow who is from the Smithsonian Institution, Mr. Dick Flynn. He mentioned the first time he met me was when he was doing research on some old-timers, and the man that brought me into business gave me my first job. And I was with him for a number of years on the circus, was Milt Robbins. And he was a very knowledgeable and kind man. I got even with him, though. He worked for me the last 7 years of his life. And but anyway, we put on a very big sideshow, and it's probably the last big sideshow was ever put together. In 19, you said 74, it was 73, I think. And Washington, D.C., which is the hometown of Irvin Feld. And that year, the Felds wanted to book the Ringling Show, which they own, into the Capitol Center, which was a new building, arena. And the man that owned Capitol Center and Irvin Feld could not get together on the terms. In fact, they ended up hating one another. And so when they agreed the Ringling Show wasn't going to play there, and Irv went ahead and booked back into the old armory in Washington, and Abe Pullen went ahead and put together his own circus. He got a gentleman to put it together for him, and I have to say honestly, I hope you're not listening, Kenneth Feld. It was probably a better show that year than the Felds. It was fantastic. But the resulting publicity between the circus wars, as they called it, caused both of the shows to do sell-out business for the times that they were there in Washington, D.C., day and dating. And one of the reasons was because Feld, who was always a very astute businessman, a great showman, and he realized he needed something that the other circus could not have. And so he contacted me and wanted me to put together for them this huge sideshow, which we did. And we had two giants, two fat people, two midgets. Sandra Reed was our albino sword swallower. Chris and a girl did a knife throwing act. We had Emmett Blackwelder, the turtle man, Bill Cole, the quarter man, Freddie Luling doing fire, on and on. It was a big show. We had about, I think, 24 acts in that show. And the one thing he wanted was to have something in advance to get publicity. And so I went to Johan Pettersson, the giant, lived 4 miles from me. He had retired. And I said, Johan, you started in America on a Ringling show. Why don't you finish your career on the Ringling show? Let's do this big show together in Washington, D.C. And so he agreed. We sent him in there a week ahead of the opening of the show. They gave him a suite of rooms in the Mayflower Hotel and a chauffeured limousine and hired a press agent, Sid Freeman, one of the greatest press agents I ever worked with, to take Johan and just publicize the sideshow. And the sideshow garnered 86% of all the publicity for these two big circuses that were there. And because that was something different. You can go to a lot of places and see a flying trapeze or a trained tiger or somebody on horseback, but how many types of sideshow acts do you know? We had them all here this week. Great performers. There's only one Tim Prindlin. There's only one Harvey Newman. And the circus did tremendous business on the strength of the sideshow. I got off my original story. Dick Flint was there, and he was a curator for the Smithsonian Institution in the entertainment division. He did not come to see me. He came to see Milt Robbins, and we sat in my trailer for about 4 hours. I think he taped stories of Milt Robbins dating back to when they had horse-drawn wagon shows. And so, as he said, it's so important to secure and gather together the information for the future. So much has already been lost, and that's why I thank CASA, because what we're doing now is the history in the future. And you should all be remembered in that history, and now you will be, thanks to Frank. And then Dick, through his influence, the Smithsonian decided they would do what they called the quote-unquote Spring Celebration. And for 4 years of the Spring Celebration, until the new federal administration came in and cut the Smithsonian's budget, they had the show every year. The sideshow was not the only thing that was there, but that was one of the principal things. And I'm very grateful that for each of those 4 years, Dick contracted with us to provide the sideshow there.
The real reason was you entertained me with great stories till all the bars closed every night.
Well, I didn't want to say that's true. Four people that were there every year was myself, Johnny Mia, John Harriet, who is a great circus horse trainer, and Little Pete. And I always said that the only reason they booked us back every year is because every day when we got finished about 5 o'clock in the afternoon, the four of us and Dick would go out and have dinner. And then we would retire to a bar where we would take turns. Johnny, Johnny Ward, Johnny, Johnny Ward, telling Dick Flint stories. And we would do this until they closed the bar and kick us out. And I said, well, that's the only reason he kept booking us back, because we kept entertaining him every night. And let me see.
Hey, no, just wipe your nose, will you? Would you just do this?
Finish your goddamn speech. I have to go to the toilet. Anyway. What more can I say?
I have no idea.
I could tell you things about this guy. Someday we're going to have to roast him.
Because I'll be good. I'll shut up.
Well, remember, I knew the Von Berg family on their carnival.
I'll be good.
He's a great guy, and I love him. I can call the names of a dozen people here, and I could talk about them, but say great things about them. And one guy sitting right there is Rob Houston, one of my very good friends from Philadelphia, a wonderful historian. He has dug things out about show history that no one else was ever able to do. And then there's a guy in a straw hat back there. Are you starting to go bald? I notice you wear a hat a lot anymore. And that's Keith Nelson.
Well, that's a kettle calling the pot black.
Keith and Stephanie and his people, some years ago, were playing somewhere in Florida. And they had a day off, and so they drove an extra 400 miles round trip to come on down and spend the day and night with me in Gibsonton, is where I live, Gibsonton, Florida. And the year before that, people keep mentioning the Meadowlands. The Meadowlands Fair, which is right at New York City in the Meadowlands Sports Complex on the New Jersey side, started having a fair, I think 17 years ago, and we have been there for 16 years. The guy that owned that fair, Marty Guerin, a hell of a good guy, and was born and raised in Coney Island, and he just dearly loved sideshows. And so after a couple of years, we were booked in there with the carnival, I started getting a contract from him because he wanted to make sure that whatever carnival was there, he would still have the sideshow. And so we've been there with him every year. Great guy. And anyway, you cannot hire any extra help in Meadowlands, just for the simple reason the Meadowlands Sports Complex is a huge area, and there's no residence area right around it. And so you don't get any guys coming out, hanging around, saying, hey, can I go to work? And so We went to a labor pool service, and I wanted to hire four guys. And they said, okay, I didn't have credit established with them, so I had to pay cash in advance, $14 an hour for some guys. They said, we'll have some men there tomorrow morning. One of them was a big, strong guy. My God, he was more muscular than John Hartley. And I thought, oh, this guy's going to be great. He can do a lot of work. But unlike John Hartley, this guy wasn't muscle. He was just steroids. And he couldn't even swing a sledgehammer. Another guy came out, he's dressed about like I am now. So what the hell are you doing here? He said, well, they told him to come out here and go to work. I said, what kind of work do you usually do? He said, I'm a computer data processor. I said, I don't think you can put up a tent. But the mistake, of course, I'd already paid in advance for 6 hours for these guys. And we had a hell of a time getting the show up, even the worst time getting it down. The show closed as a fair on a Sunday night, and we never got it loaded and ready to go. It was Wednesday afternoon by the time we got it finished. There was nobody there, me and Chris and Jimmy Long. And so when Keith and his folks visited, I thought, this is an opportunity. And I said, what are you folks booked for the dates of such and such to such and such? And he said, oh, we're going to be home. We're laying off right at that time. Good. Would you like to play the Meadowlands? Yeah, that'd be fine. Okay. So we talked about money and made a deal. And so I said, now, you know, part of the thing is you have to help put the show up and take it down. Because I missed whatever you said.
He said you told him that when he got there.
Yeah, oh yeah. And because if the show don't get up, you don't need any actors. And so I got to say, his crew saved my life. They helped put up the show. They worked like troopers, which they were, and they also did those hard days there, that fair on weekends, and 4th of July opened at 11 in those days, 11 in the morning, and closed at 2 in the morning. And you can do 40 shows if you're doing big business and snapping them through that way. And so after that, I had them at least once more, they came out and helped me in Meadowlands. But I think the last time was 2 years ago, and Stephanie and Brian and some of the other guys, they came out and helped me put up. And but Keith was very busy, and he couldn't get out for another day or two. Chicken! Got out of the setup.
No,
anyway,
chicken salad.
Yeah, chicken salad, that's right. They're great and I love them. They're a wonderful, wonderful group. And here, and there is a case of a man who is right now promoting a sideshow that will be the equivalent of what Hubert's Museum was on 42nd Street in New York, where I worked one winter, the winter of 60-61, I was in that show.
It was Wednesday, about 3:30.
Yeah, and I think that Keith, among the many of you here, is an up-and-coming showman who's gonna be doing great things in this business in the future. And who else can I talk about here? Oh God, I don't want to miss anybody, but I would miss most everybody because I've known all of you, most of you, so long. Paul Gothiel, God bless him. He comes every year somewhere where we are and takes pictures of the show. And
he really just comes out for the pig races.
Well, he does that too.
I know.
And, and I feel so fortunate in knowing him because Chris and I have had not one or two, but several shows over the years, not just sideshows, but other kind of shows. I don't even have a picture of them because neither of us take pictures. And just never, it wasn't the case that we didn't want to. You get busy, you don't have time. We never took pictures. And so my pictorial history is going to be whatever Paul has done over the years. And I'm very grateful, and I'm grateful to Diane to allow Paul to do this, because I know she works very hard every day in New York and in Wall Street. And AJ, well, he did his thing. He was a great clown. Can you imagine holding the same job for 35 years? And he had been pretty good to do that. And Todd is the sideshow performer I have always so admired, because he does everything with such class. He's such a gentleman. And I just spent 7 days in Toronto. I went up there for the Circus Historical Society. And when I can, I go to their conventions, and I, as they call it, giving a paper. I sometimes do little things, like I gave the president a roll of toilet paper a couple years ago. But
that's a lot of shit.
And he cleaned up.
Oh, right. You're on a roll now.
Enough
of this toilet humor.
Anyway,
I flushed with humor.
Anyway, what they did not tell you about Al Stenzel sitting there, not only is he an author of these fine new history books. And if you haven't seen Girls Show, this is a book you should get.
Yes.
Because as the talkers used to say on the Bally, hey fellas, if you like girls, you're gonna love this show. And if you like girls, you're gonna love that book. There's some terrific pictures in it. And I saw a few that didn't even get published in the book. And because of Al Stensel, I had a wonderful, printed by Carnival Publishers, which did the series of books, the Pictorial History of the American Carnival. And if you're interested in that history, you should see those books. And I believe that I saw some for sale
on the last set. The went
the last set
oh,
went.
I, okay. And I
Bob, Bob. Oh, Bob Bob. Okay.
And Al's
speak up now.
And
we're looking forward to Al's new book, which will be, actually, he got so much material when he did his research that the publisher said, you're going to have to split this book in two. So the one book, I guess, Al, is what? Mainly about other types of carnival shows, but then one book is going to be entirely on sideshows. So that's going to be just great.
Did I mention I had six more of mine left?
We don't want to hear about your book. I read about the book and I felt cheated when I read this book, because it's something about how to be successful in schmoozing.
Golden rule of schmoozing.
Well, and I only just glanced at the thing and I thought it was how to be successful in sodomizing. very disappointing. Anyway,
that is so false.
Get over here.
Did I mention he was reared on the carnival?
I've had it up to here with him.
As Sophie Tucker said in her book, Some of These Days, and was describing working in vaudeville, and she was the star, so she worked second to closing, and the stagehand made a mistake and opened the curtain behind her, and they were getting ready for the closing act, which was Schaefer's Midgets. And she said, I turned around and found I was up to my ass in midgets. And a very kind gentleman who always wants to buy artifacts from me at prices I feel cheated about. James Taylor is a person who is helping to preserve the history of sideshows with the American Dime Museum, and I've promised to send him something to put in his museum that would be one of, you know, we in our sideshow, not only do we have the 10 acts, but we also have over 100 exhibits, including life-size wax figures of the famous freaks of the past, Lentini the Three-Legged Man, Lalu the Double-Bodied Man, Betty Lou Williams the Four-Legged Girl, on and on. Anyway, I wanted to promise to give James something that would be a spectacular attraction that everyone would want to pay a lot of money to see and make his museum a huge success. And I don't want to give up any of my attractions in the show because they're still making me some money, but I here. You'll be able to raise your price by at least $1.
Actually, Ward, that's just kind of a loan because he was telling me that he just got this lovely jar that is about this wide and about this high, and a 100-gallon container of formaldehyde. Yeah, so whenever you're ready, just give him a call.
I hate to disappoint him, but Dick Flint promised me 20 years ago that when I die, they will put me in a great big bottle of formaldehyde in the Smithsonian because I don't want to get out of show business.
Yeah.
I'm told they're going to give you an enema and put you in a baggie.
They could give me a hypolonic and bury me in a little tin box, right? Now, there's one other person I must pay a little tribute to here today, because...
Got to be the cameraman. It's the only one left.
I know how them guys are. He took James' money. Don't even have film in the camera. But there's a lady here who... I'm getting ahead of my story. I said I wrote four books, okay? One of them was the biography. The second, which I already got the plug-in for, My Very Unusual Friends. I took 100 of the people who had worked for me over the years. And I shouldn't say worked for me. I never had employee-employee relationships, but they were all my friends. And we had 100 of them. We wrote the stories about, and that's My Very Unusual Friends. And then, at the request of a publisher, I wrote a how-to book. And please, don't ever follow the directions in my book, if it ever is published, on how to swallow swords or eat fire. I guarantee you'll get hurt. I don't know what the hell I was writing about, you know. I never did these things. I only presented them. But it was called Secrets of the Sideshow. And it's been at the publisher for several years. He advertises it in his catalog, but he's never printed it yet. And then about...
How many has he sold?
Well, having not printed it, he hasn't sold many. Then about 35, 40 years ago, I wrote a novel, and the title of it was Gypsy No More. And I sent it out, and the content was a little too strong, I think, for that era. And so I have rejection slips from the finest publishers. And finally, I'm not sure how it all came about, but I know it was through James Taylor, that there is a lady who got the book and she edited my horrible writing and my grammatical errors and changed it from first person to third person, I think you call it, don't you? And made the book from just a poorly written story to what I think is a masterpiece. Kathleen Kutchner. Here he is. Kathleen also, I think, wisely changed the title. And it's Gypsy Hot Bloods, Gypsy Hot Bloods. And we hope that it will be out by this late this fall. So please watch for that, because I need the money. And so God bless all of you. George M. Cohan, my mother thanks you, my father thanks you, my sister thanks you, and I thank you. Good day, everyone.
Well, you know, at no additional charge, not only is this been a weekend tribute to Ward Hall, but we've had a couple other things going on here, one of which is the first ever Sword Swallowers Association convention. And I'd like to turn this over for a moment to the man who has decided to bring us all together, all of us steel glommers, and I refer to Mr. Dan Meyer.
Yeah. Well, to make this really, really quick. I'm going to kind of piggyback on this very quickly, if you'll indulge me for just a second to kind of do a sidebar here. I'd like to recognize John Trower and John Stewart. Red Trower, Red Stewart, if you could come up for just a moment, please.
Apparently, I didn't know you had a kid.
I swear to myself, he's not mine. That's a redhead joke. You'll get it later.
We'd like to give these two gentlemen what we're going to call the Golden Sword Award, even though they're not necessarily made of gold, for lifetime achievement as sword swallowers. You don't have to swallow, that's kind of sharp. For lifetime achievement as sword swallowers and honorary members of the Sword Swallowers Association International.
Thank you.
Thank you. One more thing, I'd like you two gentlemen to help me with this. We have a little certificate here for Mr. Ward Hall that I'd like you two gentlemen to read and to give to Ward. Ward, just before I
got
say
your
this.
Your glasses handy? I ain't got mine handy.
Ward had Why asked me this back? Morning, he said, what does it take to be a member of the Sword Swallowers Association?
Don't tell the dog.
And I said, you have to be able to swallow a sword. And he said, well, what constitutes a sword? And yesterday in our meeting, we decided that if you can swallow 8 inches, that's considered swallowing a sword. So, Ward, would you like to give it a try? We would like to make Ward Hall an honorary member of the Sword Swallowers Association International Lifetime Achievement Award.
Thank you. I feel very honored to be in this tremendous company of people that I so admire.
It's going to take another hour.
I can never swallow a sword
around
in a million years, and I so admire people who can, and I thank you from the bottom of my heart. Thank
you
very, very much.
Thank you. And on behalf of Roderick Russell and myself and sword swallowers around the world, we'd also like to thank Mr. Frank Casa for putting this whole thing together and for spending his
entire
Now, since we're moving this direction anyway, I think it's time to turn over to the man who made this all responsible. You know, there have been many, many strange, unusual things in the sideshow. There was one of the great attractions in the sideshow was a character by the name of Zip, who was known, worked for P.T. Barnum, was known as the What Is It? The Enigma, the Nonpareil. Basically, we have a kindred attraction over here, which is Franco, the why did he do this? So therefore, if you all step down to this end of the tent, ladies and gentlemen, I'd like to introduce you to the one and only Franco Costa. Thank you.
Sideshow fan, this has been beyond my wildest fantasy of any experience I could have ever had, and for it to come to this bruitation, I can't put it into words. The gratification I feel. Why did I do it? We basically, to be very brief, 9 years ago, I had love and interest of the tattoo industry. That has love and interest today is what we know Ink in the Valley. It's 9 years we're established. We've made changes, but we've brought tattoo community together. I also, for many years had the same love and interest in Sideshow. I don't tattoo. I'm not a tattooist. I've never turned a tattoo machine on. But I wanted to help. So we made Ink in the Valley. I don't do an act. I've never owned a show. But I want to help. And the opportunity had presented itself to piggyback this event onto Ink in the Valley. And it seemed to me that the tattoo and Sideshow romance, history, whatever you want to call it, connection that's been there is possibly still there, and maybe it would be fertile ground to sow seeds. What I hoped to accomplish with this weekend, along with honoring, there are no words that haven't been said today that I could add to describe this man.
There's a few four-letter ones. Well,
but we wanted to contact Sideshow's history while it was still here and viable and accessible to us, and take Sideshow's present and hopefully somehow get you all in one place to plan, to organize for, to ensure that there be a future, because I'm a fan. There's so many people that need to be thanked, that need to be recognized.
When you got a guy that's my size, do you need to put the table out?
Bruce doesn't want to try to sneak in here. Secondly, while you're there, mentioned throughout the event, someone else who couldn't be here, but I really think in my heart and my fans' heart should be recognized. I'd like to present, and I guess have Ward accept, the Sideshow Gathering 2002 Lifetime Career Award, the With It and For It Award, to be presented to Pete Poobah Tahern.
Yeah.
Live, through performance, as we all do, but some people take it as far, you know, to a further level. I wanted to recognize the Sideshow Gathering, Ink in the Valley 2002 Living Sideshow Arts Award, and I would like to present this to the stage, use the stage. We're finally, you're all here. I keep not even wanting to say we, you know what I mean? But you're all here together. So make the
you're
most
one of us. Yeah. Yeah.
Frankly, we've got to have people who enjoy it and love the work.
With that in mind, the last award I wanted to present was to the Sideshow History Preservation Award, and I'm presenting that to the American Dime Museum. But I plan to spend as much time as I can with you today. Stay online, keep in touch. You've got
to. The way it works out here with all this, on your way out, just take care of the I don't even know what the thing on this is going to be.
Yeah,
but. But they have a buffet fee for the thing. So
is there anybody from the hotel in the room right now? So if he's all run out real quick.
Yeah, no, but, yeah.
I can't but, really yeah, do much about
whatever,
it.
Whatever you had, if you had the buffet.
Like industrial.
So we're down there all the time. We usually just kind of go down and jump out front, but now.
So where's let me take a look.
Thank you.
Sit on your car.
I will indeed.
By the way, just for the, while the camera's running here, I still owe you $20 for eBay. So. I owe you $20 for Esteline Pike photo on eBay.
To you yet.
I know it. I haven't given you the money yet. There you go.
Hey, be sure that you write me a note, because between now and the time I get home, I'll forget. I hope I didn't tell you to somebody else.
Do me a favor, collect any other photos you got of sports followers.
I run the driver across the street.
You're Dan.
Yeah, I'm on
the way.
Furry.
Thank you very much.